Okay, good afternoon. I feel very privileged to act as a moderator for this session. And I also like to thank the BOK, KIAP, and PIIE to organize this tremendous art conference. We already learned a lot from the morning session and the keynote speech by Olivier Blanchard, and I'm sure that we will learn more from the next session. In order to save the time, I'd like to, I don't want to go through the biographies, but they are available in the book, I believe. And we are already, 20 minutes late, but on top of that, I'd like to, add some more variation. I'd like to borrow 5 minutes from discussion session to give more time to presenters and shorten 5 minutes for discussion.
Can I suggest you go as long as you need to go and we slightly shrink the final panel, because the final panel,
okay,
90 minutes is too long.
Yeah, they were worried because they had to work to talk about.
And whereas we don't want to deprive our discussion, so you do what you think.
Okay, okay, thank you very much. So I'll give the each speaker 20 minutes to present his paper. And the first speaker is going to be Joe Gagnon. Please, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So I'll get right to the summary of the paper in case you want to walk out. I'm going to take a pretty sort of straightforward view. The question, one of the key questions that we have today is whether globalization, financial integration mean that smaller economies cannot have independent monetary policy. And I think I'll give a definite answer. I would say no. I don't think that's right. Conclusions I want to push would be that sound monetary policy with a flexible exchange rate, and of course it's important that a flexible exchange rate doesn't mean you have good monetary policy, but it gives you the opportunity to have good monetary policy. And if you do, then you get greater domestic stabilization than otherwise. So I show this across countries. I also have a case study of Canada, which is a good country to study in this regard. And then finally, I do think that there is something to the idea that exchange rates are too volatile. And people have expressed a lot of concern, but I agree with that. I think that countries do have some ability to influence exchange rates through foreign exchange intervention separately from monetary policy. It doesn't require you to subordinate monetary policy to this, and it's not perfect, but there's some ability. Also, we could use capital flow measures, which I think Michael Klein will discuss later. I will not discuss. But that these policies really should be aimed at sustainable and small current account balances, because I think that's where the damage from exchange rate volatility happens. So a reminder, we talked about this earlier. The famous international monetary trilemma says that countries can have only two of the following three desirable properties, which are independent monetary policy, open financial markets, and a stable exchange rate. Now, as was mentioned earlier, some recent papers have argued that even if you give up on a stable exchange rate, let the exchange rate be flexible, you may not be able to have both of the first 2 points, independent monetary policy and open financial markets. My reading of these papers is that they're confusing correlation with lack of independence, and those are not the same thing, and we'll discuss what I mean by that. However, it is true, and this also came up a lot today so far, that whether monetary independence is useful to you, or it becomes useful to use, attractive to use, does depend a lot on the presence of currency mismatches. And if there are harmful currency mismatches, in particular borrowing in foreign currencies by people who don't have foreign currency revenues, that actually introduces a instability in the economy that makes it less attractive to use your monetary independence. In this regard, Korea has made a very strong progress between 97 and between 98 and 2008, there was major improvements. And since 2008, I think there were still some further vulnerabilities there. There's been further progress made. So I welcome the regulatory changes the Bank of Korea, in particular, has made since 2008 to try to further minimize these kind of harmful imbalances. So in talking about monetary independence, I'm going to jump straight to what I think is the point of monetary independence, which is that you want monetary independence because you want to get good macroeconomic outcomes. You want stable, low inflation and stable growth and employment. And so I'm going to say that achieving those objectives does seem to be possible with a flexible exchange rate, which implies to me that you did have some useful monetary independence. So the first thing the paper does is it regresses some measures of macroeconomic performance. And there's seven measures here going across the table. Each of them is regressed separately on a number of control variables, which I won't discuss, and then some dummies for the monetary regime. And this regression excludes the largest economies. So the seven largest economies are not in this regression because I want to focus on the small and medium-sized economies. The dummies, which I'll now talk about, are a dummy DIT for inflation targeters. These are countries that had flexible exchange rates and targeted inflation is about 25 of these countries. Then the other dummy, the HF dummy, is for countries that had a very firmly pegged exchange rate with a tight sort of area. It could be common currency or just a tight exchange rate peg. And there's about 50 of these countries. And then there's about 100 other countries that didn't have such a well-defined monetary regime. So then the question is, how does each of these macro outcomes respond to these dummies? And the regression is based on the 6 years during and after the Great Recession, so 2007 through 2012. And the controls are all predetermined variables from before that period. And then the dummies are also based on the regimes before it in 2006, before this period. So they're all predetermined. There's no endogeneity concern. What I find, and this is consistent with what one of the papers said this morning, is that for the growth of real GDP, both the level and the variability, there's not much difference here. If you look at column 1 and column 4, the differences are small, but not statistically significant. So it's true that, as an earlier columnist, panelist said, exchange rate regimes don't have a big effect, at least in this sample, on GDP growth. But in terms of the other, but to the extent that they do, inflation targeting looks better than a fixed exchange rate. But it's not significant. If you look at the other measures, there is a very large and significant benefit to having a flexible exchange rate with inflation targeting. In column 2, you can see inflation is much lower in these flexible exchange rate IT countries than in the PEG countries or the other countries. And that's a highly significant result. If you look at column 3, these countries had a much smaller rise in unemployment during and after the recession, and that's a hugely significant result. Looking at the variability of inflation, column 5, countries that had flexible exchange rates and inflation targeting had less variable inflation, more stable inflation. That's very significant. Column 6 is the variability of nominal GDP, which some people argue is maybe the best single measure of monetary outcomes. Again, inflation targeters with flexible exchange rates had the best outcomes, and it is significant. And finally, the variability of unemployment, which is an important measure, also notably better, marginally significant with inflation targeting. So across the board, there does seem to be some macro benefits from letting your exchange rate be flexible and having a good monetary framework. I'm now going to turn to the second part of the paper, which sort of goes further and says, well, let's look at a case. One of the inflation targeting countries in that regression was Canada. And I think Canada is a really interesting case. If you're worried about US monetary policy swamping a country and preventing it from having independent monetary policy, the country you would look at first would be Canada. Canadian economy is much smaller than the US economy, about 8.5% the size, so the effects pretty much all flow from the U.S. onto Canada. Exports from Canada to the U.S. are fully a quarter of the Canadian economy. That's enormous. There's no country in any emerging market, except possibly Mexico, that is as exposed to the U.S. economy as Canada is. Financial markets are completely open. Canadian claims, financial claims in the U.S. are 56% of Canadian GDP. U.S. financial claims on Canada are 78% of Canadian GDP. This is enormous. As we saw in the earlier paper this morning, the U.S. is one of the top safe haven countries. Canada is one of the top non-safe haven countries. So here you have two economies side by side with open markets and massive financial connections, and one's a safe haven and one's the opposite. So you have the potential for massive disruptive flows between the two. So did this cause Canada to not have independent monetary policy and to have bad macro outcomes? Well, and by the way, I should mention, one thing that's important is that Canadian liabilities to the US there are not in US dollars. They're in Canadian dollars. So this gives Canada the potential to have independent monetary policy that's useful. Okay, so I'm not going to right now cover the correlations that's in the paper. I'll talk about them as we go through. But I'm going to go through a series of slides on the principle that a picture is worth a thousand words. In each slide, I'm going to show a solid line, which is Canada, and a dotted line, which is the US for comparison. So in the first slide, what we have is monetary policy, short-term interest rate, the overnight interbank rate. And as you can see, there is a significant correlation here. So the Canadian interest rates move with US interest rates. Not too surprising. These economies are tightly linked, face a lot of common shocks. But interestingly, there are large deviations of hundreds of basis points lasting several years at a time. So when they want to, the Bank of Canada is able to adopt a different policy from the United States. And the question is that are those differences enough to get them better outcomes? And that's just an empirical question, which we'll look at. Now here's the interesting picture. Long-term interest rates. Despite those differences in policy rate, the bond yields in the US and Canada are enormously correlated, even more correlated than the short-term rates. The correlation of these two lines is 0.96, which is enormous. And if you do it in terms of the monthly changes, it's 0.86, which is also very high. This kind of pattern is what lies behind the literature I mentioned, which says, would say, Canada does not have monetary independence because its bond yields are driven by the US market. This picture would confirm that point. But the question then becomes, so what? Did that mean by itself that Canada didn't have monetary independence or not? Well, what would a lack of monetary independence mean? It would mean that Canada didn't have good monetary outcomes. Canada didn't have stable inflation. Canada didn't have stable employment. It was forced to go along with US monetary policy, which was obviously tailored towards US goals. Is that true? Well, I think we'll see it's not. In particular, there is one variable that is not that highly correlated between the two countries, and that's the exchange rate. What I've shown here is the US and Canadian exchange rates against the euro. Now, if you divide these two lines by each other, you get the US exchange rate against Canada. But I've plotted them separately here. There's correlation between them, but in levels it's not very high. And what's going on here? Well, the one difference between the US and Canadian economies is that Canada has a bigger resource sector. It's more of an oil producer than the US. And that's not huge. It's only about 8% of Canadian GDP, but it's enough to matter. When the oil price is high, the Canadian dollar goes up. This is not a bad thing. It actually helps to move resources into the oil sector in Canada, sort of get labor into that sector. The exchange rate is a helpful thing, signal to get the economy adjusting. In the period around 2010 to 2013, oil price was high, and so the Canadian dollar was strong. Since then, as the oil price has fallen, the Canadian dollar has depreciated. It's fallen 30% in the past 3 years against the US dollar. That's an enormous change. And in fact, it's pretty amazing when you realize that manufacturing, almost all of which is exported to the US, if it's exported anywhere, is a bigger sector of the Canadian economy than oil production by quite a bit. So how do these manufacturers survive? Well, I'm not going to say that exchange rates don't matter for exporters. They do. But it's not as it's not as damaging as you might have expected. Canada did seem to be able to survive, as we'll see. So this is the thing that is not, that gives you the sense that there is some monetary independence. But let's go to the bottom line, which is, in the end, given the high correlation of bond yields, the relatively low correlation exchange rates, what was the overall outcome? Well, the overall outcome is at least as good in Canada as the US. So as you see, the inflation was a little bit lower in Canada, and the volatility was almost identical to the US, so almost no difference in outcomes there. If you look at the unemployment rate, Canada has a little bit higher unemployment on, somewhat higher unemployment on average. It has a less flexible labor market. There's really nothing the Bank of Canada can do about that. The NARU is higher in Canada, but in terms of the volatility, it's lower, and quite a bit lower. Now, the difference in volatility does drive to a large extent from the big recession, which was worse in the US, so you might say that's a bit of a one-off. But there's certainly no evidence, at least, that things are worse in Canada. The bottom line is, if you look at the volatility measures of the things we care about, which is inflation, stable employment, Canada's outcomes are at least as good as the US, perhaps a bit better. So then you can ask yourself, well, why is that? And I thought, one, I was thinking about it, well, it seems to me the answer is that they had monetary independence, and even though there was correlations, they were able to have enough difference to get them a good outcome. Now, you might argue, no, it's actually that Ben Bernanke and Janet Yellen are closet Canadians, and they skewed US monetary policy towards the needs of Canada, but I don't think that's very believable. So it strikes me that even though US had good macro policy for its own needs, this did not prevent the Canadians from having good macro policy for their own needs. So it's sort of the ultimate test of independence is whether you get a good outcome, whether you're able to get a good outcome in monetary objectives. So finally, the final section of the paper considers the issue of exchange rate volatility. As you saw, there are very large swings in exchange rates. Some of that makes sense because of oil prices and the structure of the Canadian economy, but some of it may be excessive. Some people have argued that, and I have some sympathy for that. So the reason we would care about that is if the exchange rate was swinging in a way that made external imbalances that were large and unsustainable, and that might be damaging to correct. You might either kill too many exports off or have too many, create too many exports that you couldn't keep forever. So you kind of want to damp those swings. Well, there's some new research done by me, but also by Olivier Blanchard, our lunch speaker, suggests that maybe there is some ability for central banks to use sterilized exchange rate intervention as a tool to assist in stabilizing some of these exchange rate movements. I wouldn't sacrifice monetary independence for that goal, but it's another tool, a separate tool which could be used. And I would argue that it shouldn't be used to stabilize the exchange rate per se, but rather to stabilize the exchange rate in the context of a small and sustainable current account. You don't want that to go out of whack. So I'm going to close, the final slide is on the case of Korea, because one of the things here, the regressions that I've run and that Olivier and his colleagues have run, it's very important to have what we would say in econometrics, the right instruments. What you really need is to capture when was there a change in intervention that was arguably exogenous to what's going on. The problem being, of course, that intervention often is responsive. It's responding to pressures, and then it masks the effect of intervention with the cause. And so you have to disentangle the cause and the effect. This is the classic econometric problem. Well, there was an episode in Korea, which I'd be interested to hear people's comments. It strikes me as illustrative of what's going on. In Korea, coming out of the Asian crisis, the government of Korea was buying a lot of foreign currency reserves. That's the dashed line. to rebuild after the Asian crisis. That's in 2000. And it had a current account surplus of about 2% of GDP. That's a solid line. And then going into 2001 and 2002, these came down towards sort of small and sustainable levels. And so it seemed to be on a nice glide path to something sustainable. Then, starting in sort of 2003 and really expanding into 2004, the Korean economy experienced an export boom, a lot of demand for Korean exports. And this was pushing up the Korean exchange rate. The Korean exchange rate is the dotted green line there. That started to rise. The Bank of Korea tried to fight the appreciation by rapidly increasing intervention to sort of hold down the won. But it didn't do it so much as to fully succeed. The won continued to rise, but the Bank of Korea was fighting that rise. And by holding it down, exports boomed. And so the current account surplus just took way off. But then an interesting thing happened. In late 2004, there occurred a political outcry against the intervention policy. Politicians and journalists were pointing out that the reserves that Korea had bought were losing money for the Korean government because the Korean won was appreciating still, so the dollar was falling against the Korean won. And this was costing the Korean taxpayers money, a cost of the intervention that was unpopular. So starting in 2005, the Korean government made a dramatic change to its policy. It said, okay, we have enough reserves, we're losing money, we're going to stop buying so many reserves. That's the exogenous shift. Intervention collapses, the dashed line goes way down in 2005, and the exchange rate now goes up faster. There's less holding down of the exchange rate, which is allowed to rise with market pressures. And what happens to the current account? The current account comes way down. So we have a clear moment in which there's an exogenous shift in policy and you see the effects. And so it tells me that, in fact, this does argue that intervention does really have effects. It's not clear that you can micromanage things, but you can lean against the wind. And I would argue Korea was doing too much of that in 2003 and 2004, and then shifted to a better outcome in 2005 and 2006. Anyway, I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you very much, Joe. And the next speaker is Dr. Lee Ju-young at BOK. Another 20 minutes, please.
First of all, thank the organizers of this joint conference for offering me an opportunity to present this paper. Personally, it's my honor to meet in person Professor Blanchard, whose undergraduate textbook made me interested in macroeconomics long time ago and led me to this career. My name is Ju-young Lee, economist at the Bank of Korea. And the title of this paper is Estimating the Effects of FX-Related Macroprudential Policies in Korea. This paper is co-authored by Dr. Kim, who is sitting there, and me. Here is the outline of the slide. And experiencing two big crises, Korea has learned the lesson that large swings in capital inflows may threaten the economy. Hence, due to large capital inflows until 2010, a series of FX-related macroprudential policies have been introduced. See the large short-term foreign borrowing in the left figure and large bond inflows in the right figure. Table 1 reports the chronicle of various FX-related macroprudential measures. Leverage caps on FX derivatives position directly regulate net FX forward buying and indirectly regulate short-term foreign borrowing of banks. Note that ceilings are different depending on bank types and have changed a few times. Stability levy was imposed on non-deposit liabilities of bank, and the rates were different depending on maturities. There were also resumption of taxation and reinforcement of regulations on loan use. Whether these policies are appropriate or not is one big question, and whether these measures have been effective or not is another question. In this paper, we focus on the latter question and investigate the overall effectiveness and individual policies' effectiveness. I will skip this part. And there is a huge literature about measuring the effectiveness of these measures, but the evidence is somewhat mixed. There have been a few papers which focus on the case of Korea. As you see, various methodologies are applied. This reflects the difficulties of estimating policy effects. Here, we adopt a promising method of qualitative VAR to investigate the overall effects in Korea. This task has been done by Dr. Kim, and we develop a counterfactual analysis in a different way to explore individual policy effects on various types of bank and various maturities. I will briefly introduce the two methods in an intuitive way. In the qualitative VAR, the essence is to derive latent policy stance variable from binary policy variable by using econometric model. Latent policy stance variable is assumed to follow truncated normal and Markov chain. Monte Carlo simulation is applied to the state space representation. After getting latent policy stance variable, we do standard impulse response analysis. In the counterfactual analysis, Bayesian VARs are separately estimated for different periods, for different types of banks, and for different maturities. Whole periods are divided into no policy regime and policy regime. We do forecast at the same period using estimated coefficient of each regime. We control environment variables to follow the same future paths across two conditional forecasts, then we compare these conditional forecasts. But by nature, there's no causal interpretation. However, for some policies like regulation, we can interpret the differences in conditional forecasts across regimes as a policy effect. I think I explained enough, so I will skip this part. And for the capital inflow measures in the qualitative VAR, gross capital inflows and foreign borrowing of banks and bond inflows are used in turn. Other variables, global liquidity, big industrial production, and latent policy stance variable are also used. Here's the estimated latent policy stance variables. Shaded areas represent policy state. And in the counterfactual analysis, global liquidity, Baltic exchange dry index, foreign borrowing of banks, and FX derivatives of position ratio and arbitrage are used. There are a few issues in the counterfactual analysis, but I'll skip most of them, but I'll mention just one thing. For the effect of stability levy, we make the rates of return different across regimes by the amount of stability levy. This is making one environmental variable different across regimes. So here are the results of qualitative VAR. In the last panel, we see that in response to a policy shock, total capital inflows fall. And next, in the next slide, in the lower panels, short-term foreign borrowing falls and long-term foreign borrowing rises in response to a policy shock. I'll skip this picture. And in sum, first, FX-related macroprudential measures have been effective in curbing excessive capital inflows. And second, the maturity of foreign borrowing has been extended, which mitigates FX market vulnerability. Let's turn to the results of counterfactual analysis. This slide is about policy effects on domestic bank and short-term foreign borrowing. The first panel represents overall effect, and other three panels denote the decomposition of the overall effects. And in the lower left panel, panel number one, all variables except foreign borrowing are constrained to follow the same future paths across regimes. Policy effect is represented by shaded area, which is the difference between no policy regime and policy regime. we do not exactly identify which policy has caused this effect. In the upper right panel, panel two, foreign borrowing and FX derivatives ratio are unconstrained. The shaded areas represent the differences in total effect in panel two and total effect in panel one. This policy effect is attributable only to leverage caps. And in the last panel, panel three, we add one additional condition to borrowing spreads. Shaded area is the difference between the total effect in panel three and total effect in panel two. This policy effect is attributable only to stability levy. Here's the same thing for the foreign bank branches, and table two summarizes the previous results. Hence, the overall effect on foreign bank branches is larger than that on domestic banks. Specifically for domestic banks, leverage caps and the stability levy both work in decreasing short-term foreign borrowing. In contrast, for foreign bank branches, only leverage caps have large negative effects. Two explanations are available. First, domestic banks are FX demanders and foreign bank branches are FX suppliers. In this region, foreign bank branches had maintained higher FX derivatives position and related transactions. This leads to different policy effects. Second, foreign bank branches tend to be insensitive to the changes in the rate of return. And this is the policy effect on long-term foreign borrowing of domestic bank, and this is about foreign bank branches. And table three summarizes the previous results. In this table, overall effects on foreign bank branches are prominent in increasing long-term borrowing. Policy effects on domestic banks are negligible. But econometric method does not suggest clear interpretation. See the table three that non-separable mixed effect on foreign bank branches is large. However, we infer this non-separable mixed effect comes from the changes in the behavior of Asian bank branches due to leverage caps. Asian bank branches have increased long-term borrowing and FX lending. FX lending, which does not change FX derivatives position, and to keep leverage caps, Asian bank branches manage assets in a way not to increase FX derivatives position. I think I will better speed up. So wrapping up, Korea's FX-related macroprudential policies have been effective, and these policies have extended the maturity of foreign borrowing. And second, these effects are quite different depending on policy type, bank types, and maturities. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your very nice and short presentation. We saved some time for other speakers. So the third speaker is Dr. Kang Tae-soo, a former BOK member, now at KIAP. 20 minutes,
please. Thank you very much. Well, I think if you ask the policymakers what is the most important systemic risk in Korea, might be household debt, probably their household debt might be their strong candidate for systemic risk. But it seems to me that at the end of the day, you know, the household debt problem is the one currency problem. So there are central banks out there to deal with this problem. But you ask which one is the more severe systemic risk, possibly cross-border capital flows. So that's the story what I'm talking right now, and I think I put myself on their policy practitioner's point of view because no, I'm not in anymore the policy maker's circle anymore. But I try to put my seat on their still policymaker's view. And I think the challenge is obviously global liquidity. How do we deal with? And first part of my presentation is cover the focus on the role of this low global market volatility in its role in terms of the capital flow pressure. And then second part of my talk is mainly on the how should we, the policymakers in EM, should respond to these challenges. Well, I think the if you left panel shows you the from 2003 to 2008, you know, right before the global financial crisis, if you see the very low volatility prevailing for about 4 or 5 years. So now that leads to the crisis, you know, and take a look at the period 2012 through throughout 15, you know, another round of very low. Volatility is out there. The right-hand panel shows that even this period from 12 to 15 is even worse because a term premium in this period is very negative right now. So which means obviously the rise in risk appetite, you know, risk on. I think seems to me the increased risk appetite triggers cross-border capital flows to emerging economies, the first left-hand side panel. And then the striking to me is that the capital flows vis-a-vis GDP growth rate, there's a strong co-movement there, which is a strong candidate for procyclicality, which is, I mean, if you take a look at Korea, capital inflows to Korea, I think you see, they kind of go hand in hand. Obviously, the entire Asia, there is clear pattern of the year go hand in hand. So procyclicality is how to deal with this procyclicality, you know. And I mean the component is very much important because if you take a look at the right hand panel, first and second panel, the risk bond market return is much higher than stock market return in the area of emerging economies. The reason why is most of the inflows is coming through this bond market instead of stock market. So as you can see the histogram out there. And if you take a look at more widest time frame, you know, and clearly you see the year after GFC, there's a strong, a strong inflows, huge inflows to the debt market to the emerging economies. The same similar patterns goes for Korea, Brazil, China, especially Korea. And why is this problem? Well, Austria's find out, that, I mean, just try to survey that out of 150 episodes, around 50 countries, nearly or more about 20% is end up with the crisis. So this goes to, Reinhardt, and obviously they try to follow survey, and they're picking up the four instances of instability due to this capital inflow surges, external default, currency crashes, an inflation crisis, and as well as banking crisis. So, EM should use available policy space response to growing systemic risk, I think. So I think doing some little exercise, you know, prior to introducing prudential regulation, you know, the EM needs to try to differentiate underlying causes of this, the drivers of surge. So question one is, what causes cross-border capital flows? Kind of very, very much simple questions. Risk appetite or economic fundamentals? Which one's my prevailing factor on this? So question is again the pull or push factors stories. I think I'm looking at the 25 years period of 24 emerging countries. I mean, the Korea is right now is emerging Asia, but I think IMF is not Korea is not regarded as emerging as U.S. Model is very simple, and then result shows that there are gross inflows. There's a push factor. If you decompose component, equity inflows, bond inflows, obviously there might be strong implication that push factor plays a role here. The second question is the what about the spread vis-a-vis volatility? So the question is, can monetary policy alone tame capital flow surges? Or the second question is, does volatility have extra powerful explanation on this capital flow? Again, I'm going to have a very simple model here, but don't ask me about the multicollinearity, where I'm not a number crunching guy anymore. So just I'm very much a simple calculation during this 2005 to 2015, 10 years. And VIX is, I think VIX is volatility variable. Spread, 1 year EM's government bond minus 1 year US Treasury bill. Dummy, just put your crisis period, July after 2008 to during the period of 2009, February. So most of the VIX variables place expected signs there. But however, the spread sign, if you take a look at spread, there might be some significant or insignificant here and there. And the later part is that spread times dummy for the VIX minus mu is that under relatively low volatility, the 1% increase in spread leads to an average 2% capital outflows from EM. Well, so the message is that spread alone doesn't explain the capital inflows. So you need to figure out, you need to incorporate the role of VIX in the role of capital flow pressure. Case in equity has a very similar outcome there, but unfortunately this time spread doesn't have any significant story out there. I'm going to go back to here later on, but anyway, the true point is monetary policy alone may not be sufficient to tame cross-border capital flow surges. Obviously the risk premium volatility needs to be tackled here. So policy implication is, I'm going to go back and then bring it back here. I'm sorry. Why? What happened? Sorry about that. Yeah. So the policy implication is this. I take this, you know, from one of my Stefan Ingves is my one time my boss at the Basel Committee. He likes this equation so much, I just take it. So normal interest rate is decomposed of real interest rate expectation of inflation plus the spread there. I mean, it seems to me their monetary policies influence the real and expectation of the interest inflation. But how about the delta, which is the risk premium, you know? Now I'm talking about the role of global market volatility. It's tremendously impact on this delta, and which means, this means kind of couple of implications you can extract from this equation. First, the macroprudential policy possibly sometimes offloading the burden of monetary policy itself. However, too much use of this macroprudential, it'll end up with burden of monetary policy. So the question, and again, this is very much a similar thing, is conventional monetary policy alone, same thing, capitals. And also, there we go, so I think that there's a reason, rationale for macroprudential policy response, as well as capital flows management would be efficient for emerging economies. That's my first policy implications. And then go back to the, how do I go back to this? Sorry to interrupt you, but and what about the? I have two to three more policy implications on with regard to this. Now, The reason why these emerging economies try to respond to this capital flows is that advanced economies were not likely to incorporate EM's concern, you know, in their decision-making monetary policy actions. The reason why is emerging economies, recipient countries, take care of its own self. Because of lack of monetary policy independence, exchange rate volatility is disruptive sometimes, you know, and it all depends on what kind of, how much the volatility of exchange rate is permitted, agreeable. So if you say, if you are financially pretty much a deep economy, your financial market is deep enough, then you can take care of huge volatility of exchange rate. But if you are in most of average emerging economies, the financial market volatility sometimes is very high, very much detrimental to the economy. So therefore, I think the overwhelming volatility should be tackled by anti-tight, ex-ante tight control. That's the mentality hanging around there. So I should very much crude up expression here, but whatever policy intervention instruments should be. Just talking about the loss of monetary policy independence. I mean, every time this morning we're just talking about the autonomy of emerging economies, monetary policies still there. But I'll tell you, I don't oppose the idea of that, but I just tell you my own experience here. Take a look at the core movement of the 10-year Korean government bond vis-a-vis the 10-year U.S. Treasury bond. Is correlation getting higher and higher? Especially from after QE and GFC, it goes up. So which means, as Joe Ganning showed us, 10-year, if you plot the 10-year government bond in Korea, as well as 10-year government bond, US Treasury bond, it's go hand in hand, exactly the same. While the central banks, Bank of Korea's policy rate, relationship with 10-year Korean government bond, the relationship is gone, which means their long-term interest rate, market interest rate, is heavily influenced by U.S. rate, and then central bank hasn't any grabbing power of this 10-year interest rate using the policy rate, so sometimes got confused, you know, also sometimes push the central bank. Very much corner solution, you know, so confused. It's a kind of conundrum here. So, what is this? Okay. International cooperation, you know, Jaime Caruana's talking about this. But whole point is that the later part of this, spillbacks, you know. Everybody talking, I mean, we're talking of spillover, but I think there are portion of global GDP, in the emerging economies portion of global GDP is way over 54, sometimes 50%, you know, 45, something like that. So something wrong, something happened here, possibly spilled back to the advanced economies. So I think that's the core way to think about these. The advanced economies, recipient countries, also source countries of this global flow, global liquidity. And what do we mean by policy tools, you know? There's some new emerging kind of thought prevailing there, even in IMF, and then there's a strong headline, Financial Times, early this year. The capital control no longer taboo as emerging market battles fight. Even the Bank of Japan governor strongly suggests their China. I don't know why their Bank of Japan governor suggests policy direction in suggestion to Bank of China. But anyway, so I think that there is a new acceptance of using of the capital control as a very policy variables. I don't want to use. The second, this is third. Third policy implication is capital outflows. How do we just tackle this capital outflows? Outflows tool is different from inflow tools, right? Capital inflows much, much easier because, why is that? Because this you can just, using your local currency power. But capital outflows, your ammunition is US dollar. So capital outflow is much, much difficult than dealing with capital inflows. So Bank of Korea Korea has already introduced this, the macroprudential tools. This is capital inflows surges. What about capital outflows? Well, foreign currency reserves might be insurance. GFSN is another way to defend the defend one. And an IMF flexible credit line. But I'm suggesting, the whole point is this. If your foreign asset is greater than foreign liability, that could be okay. So in terms of that, and net international investment position right now is positive way after 2014, consecutive year. But unfortunately, if you exclude central bank FX reserves, still we are in a position of very much negative situation here. There might be some mismatch problem here. All the financial foreign assets held by central bank, not all, just part of the bunch of the foreign assets held by central bank, while foreign liabilities held by the corporation Samsung and Hyundai. So I think too much burden and central bank has too much burden to try to deal with this. So I guess the policy incentivize to private sector to increase their foreign asset could be a way to deal with this capital outflows. The last thing is I want to talk about their policy coordination on the international institutions. I think IMF is the basic stance is 2012, their institutional view is a strong stance. And recommend emerging economies to introduce MPMs, capital flow management. You know. But OECD has their own strong stance there. I know these two institutions discuss a lot about this, but still there isn't any clear-cut sort of a harmonized or sort of conclusion, whatever. So I do understand. But I think the coherent conclusion, 2011, already G20 leaders suggest the international bodies to take account emerging market situation. But I don't know if this is right or wrong, but how can I just push the source country's policy making, you know? So don't push more dollars. How can some other countries raising his or her voice that no more dollar pumping out? That's their own policy making. So very, very important, but very, very pretty much difficult to tackle these problems. So I guess the bottom line is, I don't want to be a restrict any kind of the surges, the type of capital flows, but surge type cross-border capital flows is not shown at the 50 years ago, which was their, OECD Court of Capital Liberalization was settled. So I think these very hard rules could be more talked about. It's about time to think about this this OECD capitalization, capital code of liberalization. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for another very interesting presentation. And we'll move on to the last presentation. The speaker is Mike Klein at Tufts University.
Thanks. So let me begin by expressing my gratitude for being invited to this very interesting conference. I actually realized after I made this first slide there's a problem. This is called characterizing capital controls, but we don't call them capital controls anymore. We call them capital flow management measures. So that's much more benign. It seems nice. And the main point of my talk, it'll reflect a number of other things that have been said, But Dr. Hyun this morning said there's a range of measures that we want to think about for small open economies. But there's a question of, are these measures in fact effective or not? And so some of what I'm going to say has been said in other ways or slightly other ways. In particular, Signa made a very nice point this morning. But I want to talk about how we really think about capital flow management measures or capital controls, if you will. So capital controls or capital flow management measures represent a differential treatment of residents and non-residents. And there's a very wide range of things that can be covered by this. It can be administrative things where there are outright prohibitions or reporting or licensing requirements, or they can be market-based measures like taxes, Tobin tax or Brazil's IOF, or unremunerated reserve requirements as in Chile. And there are sort of two basic reasons for imposing capital flow management measures. One is macroprudential. So it's focusing on inflow controls, surges, asset price booms, appreciations. And I talked about this in my Brookings paper from 2012, where I characterize countries' use of capital controls as either gates or walls. And I'll talk a lot more about that. And another issue, one that's come up a number of times today as well, is the role of trilemma. And to what extent do capital flow management measures provide a country with monetary autonomy? And this is a paper that Jay Shamba and I wrote and was published last fall in the AEJ Macro. There have been very interesting changing views in capital controls. In the early 1990s, there was this view that capital account liberalization was a really good thing. And this is captured in the title of Rudy Dornbusch's article, An Idea Whose Time Has Passed. But later on, in the wake of the Asian crisis, views started to change. As early as 2002, Ken Rogoff wrote in the IMF's Finance and Development, these days, everyone agrees that a more eclectic approach to capital account liberalization is required. And then, of course, with the crisis and the quantitative easing measures, emerging market appreciation, there is discussion of inflow control. So we've already heard from Olivier and others about Mantega's currency wars in 2010. And then the Peterson Institute came out with a book in 2012 by Olivier Jean, Arvind Subramanian, and John Williamson, where they said properly designed, capital controls might even be a regular instrument of economic policy. We've already seen reference to the IMF's staff papers where there's a discussion of using capital controls as a last resort. So there's an interesting contrast here, actually, between the PIA piece, where it says it's sort of an instrument of economic policy, and a more subtle reading given by the IMF, where after you go through this long flow chart, sort of capital controls are kind of a last resort. And then finally, I'll mention an article in The Economist called The Reformation, which was about the IMF's change in its views on thinking about capital controls. The use of a religiously tinged title here is not at all lost on the readers. So the question then becomes, do capital flow measures work? Sort of another question is, are countries more vulnerable to financial market disruptions if they're more integrated? So the main point I want to leave you with today is that there's a very important distinction between capital flows that are capital controls that have been in place for a very long time, where there's a structure to support them, to enforce them, to administer them, and so on, what I call in my Brookings paper walls, and capital controls that are used episodically as events seem to call for them, which I call gates. So gates may be less efficacious than walls for a variety of reasons. First, walls in the data are very widely applied over a very wide range of assets, have been in place for a long time. But if the controls are imposed or levied on a smaller range of assets, there are ways to get around it. And we see examples of this. There's also this problem between when you realize a control is needed and when you can actually implement it. And this is sort of like the old issue of monetary policy recognition and implementation lags. So in some ways, gates might be better than walls, because you can make them pro-cyclical, you can make them more narrowly targeted, but the practical discussion centers on whether or not, in fact, these episodic controls are efficacious. So what I argue in my Brookings paper and in subsequent work is that a lot of the discussion about capital controls is actually discussion about episodic controls. But a lot of the lessons about capital controls are drawn from walls, are drawn from long-standing controls. So China seems to manage things, so Brazil should use capital controls. I think that's just sort of an incorrect way to look at it. So here's my example. I have a laser pointer. There it is. It doesn't really show up. So I have a pretty loud voice, so I'll walk over here. So this is showing nominal exchange rates around QE2 in August of 2010. And what happened is, during this time, I plotted the currency of Brazil, Chile, and Korea. And you see that after QE2, there's this kind of very common movement, appreciation of these currencies against the dollar. These vertical lines represent impositions of capital controls. And here, a B means it was done by Brazil, a K means it was done by Korea, K and B was done by both. And Chile, thanks in part to our discussion today, did not impose capital controls during this period. And what you see is there's this remarkable coherence of all these currencies through this period, despite the fact that capital controls were being imposed. It's very hard here to see systematically the effect of a capital control on the currency appreciation. And the capital controls were being put in place largely because of the concern about the appreciation, the currency war concern. But the yuan and the Chilean peso and the Brazilian real moved together, they all kind of come down here. So you'd be, you know, stretching things a bit to say, well, finally, this capital control by Korea or by Brazil in April or in July, that's what brought it about. So this is non-econometric evidence of the inefficacy of capital controls. But there's also econometric evidence, at least with respect to monetary autonomy. So to save time, this is the fifth time today you've seen the policy trilemma triangle. I actually, with all due modesty, I think this is the nicest depiction of it, but I'll skip over it nonetheless. This is the second time today you've seen a chart like this. So Cigna went over and beyond a discussant's responsibilities by running regressions, but this is an extraction of results from Jay Shamba and myself in our AEJ macro paper, where we talk about the question of whether or not capital controls enable a country to have more monetary autonomy, and whether pegged exchange rates force a country to follow the interest rate, the policy interest rate of the base country to which it pegs. The key point here is that if you look at open countries, and I'll talk in a few minutes how those are classified, countries that we say use gates in those years when the gates were closed, and countries that were walls, that effectively had capital controls throughout this period, you see that the coefficient, which shows the extent to which you have to follow or you're following the base country policy short-run interest rate, goes down from open to closed to walls. But another important point is that these countries are different from each other. So really what you also want to look at, importantly, is the difference between when you have a peg or a non-peg. And the key point here is that you can't distinguish for wall countries whether they have a peg or not. They're less linked, but it's irregardless of the exchange rate regime. But in the other two cases, for open countries, just as Mundell Fleming tells us, you have more monetary autonomy. And for closed gate countries, and this is the key point, You also have more monetary autonomy with a float than with a peg. And so I would suggest, if you want to follow this further, to look at our paper. This is essentially the same thing that Signe has shown you earlier. And much in the way that Joe talked about what are the outcomes, we also estimate a Taylor rule in this way also. So the top of this slide is an advertisement with four other people, Andres Fernandez of the Inter-American Development Bank, Alessandro Ribucci, who's at Johns Hopkins, Martin Schindler, who's at the IMF, and Martino Ribe. We put together a data set on capital controls based on data from the IMF's annual report on exchange arrangements and exchange restrictions. And the advantage of this, we think, is that we have 100 countries, but more importantly, we can break it down by asset categories, and we can also break it down by whether there are controls on inflows versus outflows. So this data set is available on the NBER data set, as well as on Martin's site at Columbian. We, you know, we'd be happy to have people use this. An article describing this is forthcoming in the IMF's Economic Review. So in some original work that I did for today's conference, I looked at six different categories. In the orange, we have categories on bonds, controls on short maturity bonds, money market, and longer maturity bonds. We have categories on different kinds of equities, shares and other securities, and collective investments, which is in red. And in green, on financial credits. So the question is, how do you distinguish between countries that are open and countries that are gates and countries that are walls? So there are two important things. One is, what is the average level of controls that a country has, but also how many times does it switch back and forth? Because those are the two dimensions along which you want to figure out, does a country use controls all the time, does it never use controls, or does it use it episodically? So when I first did the Brookings paper, I only had 44 countries, and it was very straightforward. It kind of fell immediately out of the data. But it became more complicated as I, as we increased the number of countries. And so what I did is I turned to machine learning, which sounds really, really cool, but it's basically just two lines in Stata. So this is something called a dendrogram. And basically the idea here is you want to see how things sort of accumulate or clump together, cluster together. The key thing here is if you drew a horizontal line, that would show how many groups there are. The bigger the distance, the bigger the dissimilarity. So here what's shaded in red shows that the biggest dissimilarity is between 4 and 2. So 3 is the most natural sort of clustering of these things. And 3, as it turns out, lines up with walls, gates, and open. So I, you know, if you had this all the way down, it would go all the way down to the 97 countries, with each one being sort of a very a tentacle at the end. So I cut it off at 10 for appearance sakes. As it turns out later, I found out that it actually lines up exactly with sort of the division to gates and walls and open. So given that there are 3 categories, what you can then do, which is also machine learning, which sounds really cool, which is also actually only a couple lines in Stata, so it's less impressive than one might think, is that you can ask, given you know that there are 3 categories, which countries go into which categories? So here I've done this in a couple of ways. I've color-coded in green, blue, and red the different categories. Along the vertical axis is the average number of categories that have controls over the full sample period. So a larger number, one would be that every category is controlled in every year. 0 would be that nothing is ever controlled ever. So that's along the vertical axis. Along the horizontal axis is the number of switches that you have. So I've also sort of standardized these. And the X's represent what are called the centroids, the center of the groups. This is a process by which you minimize the distance to the centroid. And it goes through many iterations and is able to come up with this. So this shows that there are these three distinct groups. And what I've done is I have the categories, the income categories different. So circles are high income groups. Squares are upper middle income groups. And triangles are lower and lower middle income groups. And you see that the open categories are predominantly high income countries. The wall category is primarily the lower middle and lower income countries. And then there's a mixture of those in the gate countries. This is a list that I'm not going to read out to you, each one by one. This is the statistics of the groups. The GDP per capita is highest for the open countries, lower for the gate countries, and lower for the wall countries. The amount of domestic credit to GDP, a measure of financial depth, is lowest for the wall countries, higher for the gate countries, and highest still for the open countries. And the PEG category is lowest for the open country and highest for the wall country. Except these things are correlated with each other. So you might want to know what's the marginal effect of all of these things. And to do that, I ran a multinomial logit as well as an ordered logit. The results are broadly similar, so I'll focus on the multinomial logit. What you see in what I outlined in red is that there's a distinction between the wall category and the open category, and between the wall category and the gate category. But the gate category countries and the open category countries are not statistically distinct along these different dimensions. And the dimensions that seem to matter are GDP per capita. So wall countries are poor. The size of GDP, this could be like China and India, for example. I haven't investigated enough, but it might be effectively China and India and Indonesia sort of being very important because they're very big. Trade to GDP. So conditional on other things, countries that trade more are more likely to have capital controls than not. And pegging. And this is excluding the euro area because the pegs in the euro area necessarily are accompanied these days by capital mobility. So this is non-euro pegs. But the domestic credit to GDP doesn't come in significant in a marginal way when you have a partial correlation and are controlling for other things. Finally, in the short amount of time that I have left, I'd like to talk a little bit about what's called the pecking order. And Olivier touched upon this a little bit at lunch because he talked about the composition of flows. This is an old idea, though. The earliest reference I know in international is Asaf Razin. And he talked about what you want to do is first you want to put controls on hot money. And I'm interpreting that as bonds, as debt contracts. And then maybe on equities, and then finally on things like commercial credits, where there's actually sort of a real side of the economy effect of it. So when I looked at this, and this shows for controls on bonds, for the two categories of bonds, on equities and on commercial credits and financial credits in this Venn diagram, it turns out that the pecking order works, but only for the higher income countries. You see that there are very few instances of controls only on the bond categories. But 43% of the cases are bonds and equities for high-income countries. 47% are bonds, equities, and commercial credits. And this is only for the gate countries, by the way, because this is the only way in which it makes sense. You want to sort of separate out the wall countries, because that's going to distort everything, because everything's going to be in that sort of middle overlap of the Venn diagram. So the one that doesn't hold very high for high-income countries is commercial credits alone, or commercial credits and bonds, or commercial credits and equities, which is what you expect because, you know, you want the credits to be able to be used for real purchases. However, this is not the same for middle-income countries, upper-middle-income countries, and low-income countries. And in those cases, especially for the low-income countries, you don't see the same kind of pecking order effect. So to the extent to which you care about compositional issues, as Olivier mentioned during lunch, or to the extent that you think that capital flow measures should be put on hot money, for high-income countries, this seems to be done. there's much less evidence that it's actually done for low-income countries. So just to conclude, capital controls are now much more widely accepted as a potential policy tool. But what I argue is that there's an important difference in the efficacy of gates versus walls. And a lot of the policy arguments are really about what I call gates, about using them episodically. Classifying countries into these three different categories shows that there are distinctions across the categories, and that finally that this pecking order, this idea of using them in a way that seems to be consistent with some broad ideas, seems to be true for higher income countries, but less so for other countries. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for excellent presentation. I'll give the each discussion 20 minutes to discuss, and then I will give the 5 minutes to each presenter to respond, and then I will open up to the floor to collect some questions, and then I'll ask the presenters to respond again. Okay, so let's get, let me invite the first discussant, Jose de Gregorio.
Thank you.
At the University of Chile. 20 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be here. I always like a lot to come to Korea. It's an extremely successful country, but it's also a country with very serious and pragmatic policy making. So there is a lot to learn. Especially now that the issue is what are the old implications, what have we learned from policy making, monetary policy for small open economies. During my talk, I'll discuss all the papers, kind of not in a formal, but as the issues come, because I think that in this session and in this day, we have two very important issues. One, regarding monetary policy independence. This is covered in this session in the papers of Cañón, Klein, and the paper of Kang. So, how works this idea of the trilemma, the dilemma, countries with flexible exchange rate, can they run monetary policy? And the other, which is a very related issue, is capital controls. And this has been discussed. It's a very nice evidence on Korea by Kim and Lee. Kang also discusses the capital flows and the role of and surges and crises. And of course, the paper by Michael is a continuation of a very successful research area. So I'll go discussing these two. So I'll first start with the trilemma, dilemma, monetary policy independence. I will work with capital account, financial integration to end up with a couple of conclusions. So what the paper of Joe present is basically he said inflation target in economies did better than PEGs, and PEGs did worse than average economy. So it's a sample in which, for a number of variables, not all of them, inflation target, I like it a lot. I come from an inflation target country. I was 10 years in the central bank, 4 as a governor, so I'm quite glad to hear that. But this is a personal comment, but we are here talking about serious stuff, so that's no role, those comments. I miss in the discussion, and this I think that is important for the discussion that we have today, to control for financial opening, for capital controls. You can add those controls, which maybe is precisely part of all this discussion, is in general is the role of capital controls, macroprudential. We can do things. I think that's not easy, but I did this in a paper with Roberto Alvarez, with a colleague, for example, for emerging markets and developing economies, and we tried to see how successful were now, which were more successful than in previous crises of emerging markets. And we found that countries that were able to cut interest rate during the crisis did better. So that's an indirect way to show that there was monetary policy independence. At least there was some effectiveness for monetary policy. There is the usual suspect, higher private credit, more financial openness, less trade openness, and greater exchange rate intervention worsened economic performance during the global financial crisis. There was no clear evidence on fiscal policy. One only issue which I think that's relevant is a financial openness. We want to see the different component, whether this was because of asset or liabilities. We look at financial openness de facto at the asset and the sum of asset plus liabilities over GDP. And what we found is that the effect came from asset rather than from exposure, which is liabilities, from asset, which we relate much more a lot to a wealth effect. So there was such a decline in global value of assets that may explain this result, but this is our explanation. What Joe does after looking at this cross-country evidence is to look at the Canada, USA, and he found that interest rates are highly correlated, but they experience large exchange rate fluctuations. And this is what we would expect from a very simple Mandel-Fleming model in which exchange rates adjust rapidly. So interest rate with perfect capital mobility will remain very close, and most of the arbitrage adjustment will be done through rapid adjustment of the exchange rate. So the monetary mechanism is working through the exchange rate, and that's fine. Now, being very strongly, as I said, sympathetic to this view of monetary policy independence, I said, well, I'm missing something on the comparison of Canada and the US, and it's the ultimate index of performance, growth, GDP. So what I found is at the left, in the left-hand panel, you have GDP of Canada and GDP of the US. Canada has grown less than since 1980. It depends when you, we can do this many things. This was very quick look at the data. Canada, and this divergence was kind of stable, is 10% less rich than the US compared to 1980. So the gap has widened by 10% in these 35 years. And then I say, okay, but let's not look at the level of GDP. This is to see long-term income difference. Let's look at growth. And what I found is that they are extremely correlated. The correlation of the rate of growth is 0.83. The yearly economic growth taken from the WIO data is extremely high. So I say, well, what's really the independence? What's Canada? What's a counterfactual? I really don't know, but this is kind of striking. Then I say, okay, let's look at Mexico, which is at the other side of the U.S. for the time being, before the wall. But the Trump wall, I'm talking. It was a joke. So what we see in Mexico is almost the same as Canada, the same divergence with the U.S. It's a different timing. They had the debt crisis, then they have the 84 crisis, the 94 crisis. And then, of course, some higher correlation, but much bigger in the case of Mexico. Now, after looking at this data, I thought that being closer to the U.S. would be a good idea. Now it seems that it's a bad idea. You are poorer. And then I say, you go to Central America. So I say, oh, I will run a regression with distance from the U.S. and I will get a negative sign that the further away, if you are in Asia, you'll do better. I don't know. I don't want to make too much about that. But this is, I think that what really is looking for, what's a real counterfactual to measure the effect of monetary policy independence. That's what I'm really missing. Despite there are some ways to measure, and Michael Klein and does it in his paper, and with Shambok, but what when we compare performance in countries, across countries, what really monetary policy independent? This is a research that I have been doing with a colleague, Pablo García from the Central Bank, and we just look at the events. We look at four events: taper tantrum, QE3 announcement, debt ceiling, and operation twist. And we see basically at the left side you have 2 months change in local yields, and at the right-hand side you have 2 months change in the exchange rate. So this is a relatively short period of time. And what we see, this big period of external shocks, we see huge heterogeneity. I will make a big point. There is a very big heterogeneity in the response of countries, and especially you have the case of taper tantrum. then you have the same for the other four events. So what we, if you take these countries, what we did is looking at taper tantrum, this is ongoing work, we see that there is an increase in interest rate and there is an increase in exchange rate. There is a depreciation. This is a depreciation of exchange rate after taper tantrum, which is a, something that we would expect. This is the monetary mechanism in a small open economy, is a depreciation. So then we did a cluster of countries taking these four experiences, and we found three clusters. We could, the red and the green and the brown could go together, but we found three kind of, clusters. The green cluster, which is the kind of countries that have mostly a depreciation, and the red cluster with a big shock, with a shock of interest rate in the world, it has a very big shock on domestic interest rate. This could be the countries that we would interpret as more dependent of or with less independent monetary policy. Let's see which are the countries. So there you have the cluster two, is a green cluster where you have mostly advanced economies and Chile that moved from cluster and South Africa. And Korea is there, the cluster three, which is could be cluster two. And the cluster one, which are less advanced economies, except we have the case of Hong Kong and Singapore. In the first cluster, and that must have to do with their exchange rate regime. Now, what we see, the other thing that we will try to see is, do these differences in behavior of countries are related to the level of financial opening, which is a big discussion in the dilemma. The closer you are, the more independent would be your monetary policy. And what we find is that indeed the countries in this cluster two are the more open countries. The only two countries that are not fully open are Chile and Korea. All the rest are, this is with the index of Michael and colleagues, and that a small number is a very open economy. So, and you find that the economies, this is, I would say this is preliminary, but you find that economies with higher level of with less financial opening are economies that have a larger impact of foreign shocks on their domestic yields. So this is kind of, I think that we'll keep doing them. So let me now go to the second point, which is capital controls, the second big point of this discussion on financial integration. Michael Klein offers this idea, which he found extremely persuasive, about gates and walls. Gates are transitory and specific controls. So they go to specific items in the capital account, while walls are big. Walls are permanent and broad-based controls. This is my way, without going into the details. Now, I have a question, and this is related to the issue of how this relates to income per capita, because in his work, he finds that walls are in the lower income countries. Middle-income countries have gates, and advanced economies, rich countries, are fully open. So my concern is whether this is a view of the transition of economies from poor to rich. So I would like perhaps to see in his definition of gates and walls some causality, whether we see a pattern of countries going from one to another, which is, I think, that may be what's going on. So this is what I said, that the result can be interpreted countries pre-financial opening and post-financial opening. So world countries are countries that have not liberalized, and this brings us the big issue and the very old issue of when, how, and whether to liberalize, and if we open, what we can do, what we can do in terms of gates. So there is one big lesson, and I don't go into detail, to just summarize, the big lesson in emerging market is that if you want to open to financial flows, first you have to have a strong domestic financial system. There was this discussion 20, 30 years ago that people said, well, you better financially liberalize with the rest of the world because you will learn. No, most likely you will have a crisis. So better to have a very strong domestic financial system. This idea of gates and walls also shows that capital account opening is irreversible. So if you have walls, you have walls. When you get rid of those walls, what you have is just you can put gates. And gates are not applied to all type of inflows, and hence are more likely to be evaded. So that this is what I think, that there is some irreversibility, and you have to be very careful in how you proceed, integrate it. So then there is some small discussion, gate on outflows. That's kind of a different issue, Iceland, Malaysia, whatever. In an emergency, you can do whatever. It's an emergency. So that's, all countries have done it. And so this is not an interesting, very interesting, or intellectually very interesting issue. Now, what's the evidence on capital, on capital controls and financial integration? We have a little bit more here. I would say there's a lot of evidence. There's a huge amount of evidence. And I two things. First, I wouldn't relate the performance of emerging market or the world economy or financial crisis for being open. This was a crisis that came from the world, and emerging markets did relatively well. And so, but we have to think this to the future, and I will be more clear about that later. But the evidence on capital controls, we can say, shows some effectiveness on financial variables. They curb capital inflows, so they could, some of them. Okay, the evidence on exchange rate tends to say that there are no effects on exchange rates. It's a very few things, papers have found some. It's very difficult. It's also very difficult to explain those results. So there is some effects on composition of inflows. I think that a very interesting finding is the Kim and Lee paper that was presented in this session, because it confirms something that perhaps we have been learning for a long time, and is macroprudential capital controls in the banking system works relatively well. They are a levy on non-core liabilities, or those are quite effective. It's basically raising the cost of capital, and it's regulation on banks. Then the constraint on bonds and the controls on bonds are quite ineffective. And this is what we have seen, and this is the evasion, and that they can do different things. So it's a more difficult the bond. Perhaps there is some evidence in Brazil that they were relatively effective in curbing the flow of bonds to Brazil. But then it comes the question: why we want to affect bonds? They affect financial stability. If I'm saying not bonds to banks, to the private, corporate, non-financial sector. If domestic firms are issuing bonds because it's cheap and there is a lot of liquidity to finance investment, is this a threat to financial stability, which is very different to banks, or we are worried about some exchange rate effect? So this is, I think, that is a very big issue. Regarding, I won't go into details, I fully agree with the discussion of Joe Gagnon on exchange rate volatility. From time to time, you can intervene on the forex market, and it helps you to have reserves. And we know that having reserves helps also in times of turmoil. So I think that is now my big issue with this, and I don't have this moral concern, is, but it's for U.S. discussion, how you the capital controls and the reserve management, how you make that consistent with the view that there shouldn't be currency manipulation. I would say, an ethical conflict. I have no that conflict, so I can give up. So the final point that I want to make, regardless of the policy goals, regardless what we do, countries, as they grow, they open financially. So countries, richer countries, are more financially open. And over time, we see this in most Latin American countries, except Argentina and Venezuela, that have done a very strong effort to be outside the normal world. So this is the case. And I have some problems here with the data for Indonesia. I put them, Indonesia and Philippines, and I think that there is some distortion because the late 90s was the Asian crisis. But in general, what we see is that there is a trend for financial opening, regardless whether you do controls, gates, walls. Then I did this, I took the data from Milesi Ferretti and Lane database, and I put that for countries with international financial position, with financial integration less than 10 times of GDP, because you find islands that are too important, and countries with more than 5,000 dollars GDP per capita, and we found the same. As you get richer, there is more financial integration. So my conclusion is that financial integration will go on and will take place. And this has to be with portfolio diversification, as you become richer, many stories we can tell, so better be prepared. Now, second, regarding independent monetary policy, I think that small open economies can follow independent monetary policy, cannot avoid the global financial cycle. I think that there is a confusion in this discussion. That as a commodity exporter, cannot avoid to be exposed to fluctuations in commodity prices, open economies cannot be fully isolated from financial or trade shocks, but they can run monetary policy. And I think that I fully agree that, in general, inflation target with a flexible exchange rate, with some times for intervention, I think that works pretty well. And I think that the main risk and why this issue is important today, because if there is something that we don't know when it will take place, but it may take place, is the return of capital flows to emerging market economies due to the search for yield. Interest rate will be and returns will be so low in the coming years that we cannot rule out that in the next couple of years, after emerging markets start growing again, there will be a lot of increasing risk appetite for emerging markets, and we'll have to deal with all of these issues. So I hope here we keep learning about how to do this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm sorry to not to mention that this, but the Jose de Gregorio is the former governor of Chile. And next discussion is the, again, former deputy governor of BOK, now advisor at IMF, Dr. Junil Kim. Please, 20 minutes.
Thank you. I would first like to thank the conference organizers for inviting me to this conference. And I'm going to begin by reading the most important sentence in my presentation. The views expressed in this presentation are those of the presenter and do not necessarily represent those of IMF or IMF policy. I have to do this one. I just start, by saying I put some context in which that this morning and this afternoon we talk about capital controls and monetary independence and financial openness. So I'd like to characterize some small open economies. This does not apply universally, but typically, when we talk about small open economies, we have what we have in my mind is some kind of countries with a significant exposure to external shocks through trade or finance or both, and often limited or some insecure access to international financial market, capital market. So some countries that may be subject to some sudden stops kind of things. Imperfect capital mobility because of either some certain amount of capital controls or just intrinsic friction in the market. So this imperfect capital mobility is somewhat important to understand how the FX intervention works here. And also, again, the less developed domestic financial sector than in large domestic economies, which means there's some kind of a distortion in the market. And this distortion, domestic distortion in these small economies may have some kind of a justification for introducing capital controls or other or macroprudential measures as a second best options. And finally, exchange rate may matter a lot, or far more, even for domestic objectives, growth, inflation, or even financial stability, probably much more than in large advanced economies. So having said that, well, I'll just turn to Klein's paper. I'd like to comment on all four papers. And Klein's paper is the longest one, so I'll begin by discussing on their papers. His paper just includes some sort of amount of a survey on the effectiveness of capital control, distinguishing between episodic or temporary controls, they call gates, and the long-standing controls, walls. And then they group countries into three categories, like open, gates, and walls, using cluster analysis. And he used a very fast technique to determine how many clusters he needs, so he comes up with three. And he finds that countries with long-standing controls or wars have lower per capita income, greater trade openness, and less flexible exchange rate regimes. And also finds the pecking order of the use of capital controls are especially at holes and especially in high-income countries. Okay. My first comment is, I think this whole topic is quite relevant because the capital controls are come back in the radar screen after the global financial crisis, and their effectiveness is highly debated. But his discussion on episodic control seems a little bit one-sided because we all know that there's a lot of econometric difficulties in dealing with capital control these issues because there's always the endogeneity issue here. And sometimes when you deal with a large number of countries, you don't know much about what is underlying objective of the controls against which to measure effectiveness. So when you measure the effectiveness, you have to first understand what was the objective of the capital control. And the question is whether the capital controls were effective in achieving these objectives or not. And third, of course, you know, there's absence of counterfactuals. It is hard to analyze these effects of capital controls. But nevertheless, as we all know and discussed a lot in this morning, there's a large body of literature finds a strong effects of episodic controls on at least the composition of flows, although some the evidence on the exchange rate or evidence on the volume of capital flows are either mixed or weak. Actually, the Olivier talked about the, you know, during the luncheon speech, he just mentioned something about the composition of capital could matter a lot, and we need more a better understanding on that. And if it is the case, probably capital control might have more important implication for policy making. And Klein starts with discussing on the Brazilian controls. And yes, that's true because the you know, Brazil has introduced a series of capital controls or restrictive measures, including tax on bond flows, and they increased the tax from 2%, 4%, and eventually to 6%. So Brazil provides a very good case of all kinds of experiment on capital controls. Brazil was not quite successful in stemming or avoiding the large or sustained appreciation of the Brazilian real until the mid-2011. But after that, we saw it in the morning that there's a big, you know, this afternoon, like a chart shows that the real, the exchange rate of Brazil, Chile, Korea, all depreciated after that period. But there is other paper by Shaman and Garcia, and they did undertake very careful study about and detailed information on Brazilian controls. And they found that certain amount of a significant impact on exchange rate, at least after the mid-2011, and they attribute that impact to the introduction of a tax on the notional amount of derivatives. So this last measure followed the initially there are a series of other measures, but their argument is that in not just in isolation but altogether, eventually this control has a certain amount of impact on the exchange rate, and their estimates suggest that the cumulative effect is about 10% of depreciation of Brazilian real, but the period mentioned by Klein during that period, this also the Shaman and Garcia's paper also suggests that at the time the impact or the capital controls were not pretty much, they find a certain amount of a significant impact in terms of statistical significance, but economically the impact was small. So it was true, but as the Brazilian controls are expanded or become more comprehensive, eventually Shaman and Garcia find some amount of impact on exchange rate of those controls. The main part of his paper is about the categorizing the capital controls, and they use they established a very extensive database, and based on the IMF's classification. And they established the so-called the data cities, like a switches from either countries, either from no regulation, no control to control, and from control to no controls kind of thing. But their data may miss a lot of the so-called de facto switches or gates, such as change the intensity of the existing controls. So controls are there, initially become no controls, the interest controls, but as long as these controls could be tightened or even relaxed, but as long as they are still there, the switch measure does not capture that. So, I mean, this is it's not a new problem. It has been there many years because the capital control data are mostly, you know, more discrete binary in case. So it is hard to capture the intensity, change in the intensity of capital controls. And for example, a partially liberal economy with existing controls that may tighten or relax its controls will not be captured by these switches. And similarly, for an open economy, only the first switch to control would be captured and not any further tightening. So this is more like a little bit incomplete data in that sense because it missed the change in intensity. So switches, perhaps the episodic controls may be better captured by the data on changes in control. Probably used this morning, the Professor Warnock's paper talk about his data set includes this kind of change in controls, which may capture some of the change in intensity rather than the introduction or on and off nature of the capital controls. And in this study, the other point is that the whole database to characterize the capital control, this study merged both inflow and outflow controls altogether. So I think this could be, I'm sorry to use the word problematic, but it's not problematic, but rather it can obscure the true facts because in that sense, I believe the analysis needs to be separated as motivations, separated between inflow controls and outflow controls because the motivations or determinants of those inflow and outflow controls are different. And pecking orders of controls are mostly, you know, referred to about, and mostly conventionally discussed is more pertinent to inflow controls. And all the discussions about the role of controls in mitigating the financial and macroeconomic vulnerabilities is also mostly related to inflows. And on outflow controls, there is a broad consensus that they should generally be used only in a crisis or according to the Jose's terminology, emergency circumstances. This is a stance by the IMF institutional view. So I think probably more information can be revealed by separating the analysis between inflows and outflows rather than merging them together as a single measure. So what is the policy implications and suggestion from his paper? I was interested in the result of the pecking order, but this pecking order suggests that, of course, it holds much better in a high-income country, but at least countries may indeed adopt controls to mitigate financial and macroeconomic vulnerabilities, which should alleviate concerns about their potential misuse. So basically what this pecking order story tells us that the countries tend to impose controls on the most risky flows, which is debt flows or bond flows. And then if this doesn't work, and probably casts the net much wider as time goes by. So if the countries follow this pecking order, some evidence of this one suggests that actually countries are using these controls in such a way that we expect them to use. So probably there's less kind of a concern. Maybe we may not be too much concerned about the potential misuse. And also it would be useful to correlate the imposition of different types of controls with the different types of flows, so to see what motivates countries to target different asset classes. This is another way to go forward. And also, finally, it could be useful and interesting to complement the aggregate descriptive analysis on pecking order of capital controls with case studies of incidences of capital control. Okay. I'm going to turn to the Joseph's paper, Gagarin's paper. And, basically, this paper is about the whole trilemma story, global financial cycle story that we have discussed this morning and afternoon again and again. And actually, this story started like Helen Ray's argument that the traditional trilemma has morphed into a dilemma. But I agree broadly with Mr. Gagarin's paper's proposition that exchange rate regime still matters. The Ray's argument is a very strong argument, like exchange regime doesn't matter as long as you have fully open financial, the open economy, the monetary independence is maybe difficult to hold. But I do believe in this kind of a trilemma still holds. That means exchange regime matters. And actually this morning, I'm sorry, I always, it's really hard to pronounce your name correctly, but her discussion this morning also suggests that the trilemma still holds rather than a dilemma. And I agree with the benefit of FX rate, exchange rate flexibility, because countries with floating rates are better able to insulate themselves from external shocks, but also macroeconomic financial vulnerabilities. It's not just macroeconomic, but also there's a financial stability implications of this exchange rate flexibility. And then more recent studies suggest that to the extent that excessive FX rate volatility under pure float poses problems, perhaps managed float or including the FX intervention may present a viable option. And there's some study in IMF by some of my colleagues in Austria, Gosh and Shaman and Gosri, Austrian and Crash. Actually, but Gagarin's paper probably deliberately avoid any discussion on the using of capital controls. You just focus on the FX intervention. But I do believe both tools, FX intervention and capital controls, both are useful in different circumstances, as noted in recent literature. You know, it's a crude taxonomy, but it's a FX intervention for currency misalignment, largely, and capital controls for financial stability risk, but also as a backstop for concerns such as economic overheating and currency devaluation in the face of persistent inflows. I mean, we can deal with the temporary surges in capital flow by using FXI, but as you find the flow is more persistent, then maybe a country may switch to from FX intervention to capital controls. So going forward, I think, perhaps the issue is how to destigmatize capital inflow controls. I'm not talking about capital outflow controls, but at least the capital controls on inflows, there is some stigma, and because of that stigma, if the countries are reluctant to use, but then probably the discussions on how to destigmatize the capital controls may be welfare enhancing. And recent paper by Ghosh and Crash is an IMF working paper, and actually they wrote a book about these things, but they offer very excellent discussion and historical background of why inflow controls have become a bad name. So basically they call the guilt by association. So during interwar period, the capital controls were imposed, used by not democratic countries, but autocratic countries. In many cases, inflow controls are associated in the end, associated with outflow controls, which are deemed bad. And also in some cases, the capital controls, inflow controls and capital flows, they also eventually translate into controls on the current account. So there is some kind of bad connotation and bad, the so-called has bad impression about so-called guilt by association. But in fact, capital controls has been extensively used during the Bretton Woods system when we have a PEG system. So the advanced countries have relied on capital controls for many years, but now it become stigmatized. But I think it's time to think about again to destigmatize capital controls, at least on inflows. some kind of a technical comment. He just runs some simple regression by comparing the performance before global financial crisis and after global financial crisis, and between distinguishing between hard peg and inflation targeting regimes. I think it's kind of a little bit narrow focus, because eventually maybe he can extend this analysis to a more normal period, like a pre-crisis normal period, see what happened to what's the performance between difference between the hard pegs and inflation targeting. But one interesting result is that in his table one, he's mentioned that inflation targeting has generally a better performance than hard pegs, but for example, inflation performance, he finds a very significant difference in a coefficient, which is negative, which means that IT regimes were more deflationary during post-crisis period than hard pegs. Now everybody's worrying about this deflationary pressure at this time, and Bank of Korea have been missing the target for many years. So perhaps this is because related to QE, there is a lot of appreciation, or during the QE, dollar depreciate, and many, because your sample increases only small and medium-sized economies. So maybe you can think about whether the IT, it's kind of interesting, IT regimes have much more deflationary bias, at least during this post-GFC periods. So maybe you can take a look at more, you know, where the more normal periods data. And also, it could be useful to analyze the performance separately between advanced economies and EMs, as central banks in the former enjoy greater policy credibility. So I want to see how this policy credibility matters in the performance of this one. The least paper, I'm sorry to say, I found this is a paper written jointly by the two authors, but I just put on the Lee's. It's Kim and Lee's paper. I'm sorry, I have to say Kim. This is an interesting follow-up to Choi, the 2014, based on conditional forecast. They use more advanced techniques to prove their case. And I just take a look at the qualitative VAR case, the result, the impulse response functions. The result seems quite reasonable to me, but several questions still remain. First one is probably the paper can be a little bit reader friendly by first describing how the leverage caps and the financial stability levy works, what is the objective of these two measures, and when they tighten this leverage cap, I wonder whether it was binding or not. So initially it was not binding. Probably it's hard to make a strong case about their impact on capital inflows. So maybe you can discuss a little bit more about this actual data issues here. And also, the authors argue that they need a little bit more or data points to estimate the coefficient more precisely, though they include both announcement dates in their dummies, like announcement effects and implementation effect, but I'm not sure whether they are sufficiently different, at least in Korea, where policy credibility is at least reasonably high. So announcement is usually goes to implementation without in all the time. So I'm not sure whether these two, including both of them, has any impact on your analysis. Maybe you can figure out how to deal with this to leverage cap and macroprudential stability levy. These two measures are different measures, and their motivations are different, probably. So maybe you needed to separate them or analyze them, analyze their impact on a separate basis. I'm not as technically advanced as those authors, but one thing that bothers me is in the impulse response, they showed a confidence interval, and this confidence interval narrows as the horizon increases. It's a little bit, I don't know, maybe it should be, or maybe I'm wrong, but usually when you run impulse response and then you see the confidence interval in Kappa should it maybe becomes larger as horizon increases more, but this competition interval just actually disappears, and so maybe you can teach me why is the case. The other one is for the counterfactual analysis, the estimated effects of leverage cap and stability labia on short-term and long-term foreign borrowing by banks appear economically meaningful, but in the end, this paper does not report the statistical significance of those effects. So they estimate effects, but probably I want to see is the statistically significant or not. Other things also, they show their impact on this estimated impact of this leverage cap and financial stability levy. It seems to me like it's not an impulse response function, but they showed a lot of charts show that the shaded area of two graphs are the effects. And the effects seems to be quite persistent. It lasts more than 30 months more. But if you look at the impulse response of the qualitative VAR, the impulse response really short-lived. The impact is, I don't know how to reconcile these two results, maybe. You can think about that a little bit more about. Okay. And finally, Tess Kang's presentation. I think his story making in his presentation is broadly in line with the findings of the existing literature on capital flows, but he just make a little bit more focus on global risk appetite as a driver. I just wrote a paper on with my colleagues, and at the time we just were interested in what explains the surge, what were the drivers of surge, and we just go for the conventional global factor or the push and pull factors. And our conclusion at the time was that global factors matter for surge incidence, but domestic pull factors affect the magnitude of surges, the size of the inflows at the country level. So basically, the global factor determines the incidence of the surges, and then this increased amount of liquidity are going into different countries depending on the domestic pull factors. So that was one of our messages at the time. So probably macroprudential measures or capital controls, they can target certain types of flows, but also it is probably important to find out what was the underlying drivers of the capital flows in order to achieve what the capital controls are intended to achieve. And also he touches upon some kind of international policy cooperation in dealing with the capital flow volatility. And arguably, the regulating capital flows at both ends, like both source and recipient countries, may lead to a better outcome. Recent studies by Anton Korenek suggest that it's a theoretical paper and suggests that spillovers could be part of efficient, in which case there is no further scope for policy cooperation. Of course, he just suggests three cases where these things doesn't work, but in broad term, there is a case for efficient, private efficient spillovers. But the same theory is kind of a relative silent on the distribution of losses and gain across countries, which is at the heart of the policy debate. So in practice, in reality, there is a case for, I believe, that policy cooperation or coordination among countries. But we need a little bit more a clear understanding on this one. And his argument about the use of all policy tools and ex-ante tightening of macroprudential tools, his argument is a reminiscent of lean versus clean argument applied to boundaries of volatile capital flows. So basically what he has in mind is macroprudential measures for lean to deal with, avoid the situation of messy cleanup later. And I think he raised a very important issue here because I know this Korea has been kind of arguing with the OECD about its macroprudential measures. And the Korean government's argument is our prudential measure is a currency-based macroprudential measures. And as we know, the capital control is the most important determinant of this capital control. It's like a residence-based controls. So there's a distinction between these two things a little bit. Actually, today, this morning, Yan Liang, he said also the distinction between macroprudential and capital controls are the lines are thick and blurry. I think international in the community needs a little bit clearer distinction, clear understanding or agreement on the definition of this macroprudential and capital control, because you know occurrence-based measure may have certain implications about the residence, but nevertheless, legally, this is quite different measure. So I hope this kind of a gap can be resolved quickly. I come up with a couple of remaining questions for small open economies, particularly emerging markets. There is some issue, like it's more like policy issue, macroprudential measures or capital controls. Should this be a first or last resort? I think it depends on the country circumstances and also the underlying driver of the capital flow. But somehow we can, as more like a broad taxonomy on how to deal, how to respond to capital flow shocks, should be using monetary policy first and then FXI, then capital controls, or maybe the other way around. Maybe more discussion could be useful on this issue. And when and how to use FX intervention on capital outflow shock. Most of the FX intervention is about on inflow shock. And some of my colleagues at the fund have been working on this issue. Actually, we just talked to Olivier a long time ago, and some of my colleagues have been working on this one. And it turned out to be quite very, very complex, at least, you know, as mentioned by Dr. Kang, the ammunition is limited for outflow shock FXI. And this very fact creates a lot of a so-called time consistency problem to begin with. So it's really hard to understand what is the optimal mode of FX intervention and what would be the impact of this FX intervention. So still the research is going on probably, so we can wait for further results there. And finally, how to avoid the misuse of macroprudential or capital control measures. This issue has been circulated among many policymakers, and there is also part of this story is a part of the debate between North and South in G20, I believe. So there might be more discussion on this one. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Before I move on, let me add a couple of questions. The first question is for Joe Gagnon. So you know, by taking an example of Canada, you show that, you know, even a small open economy can enjoy, you know, monetary independence. But many many presenters in this session also argue that, you know, many emerging economies need, you know, capital controls or macroprudential policies and so on. So what's the difference? So Canada probably haven't employed those kind of measures. So what's the difference between Canada and emerging economies? What exactly, what, you know, aspects of emerging economies require, you know, capital controls and other capital flow management measures? And the second question is for Mike Klein. I already talked about this during coffee break, but your pecking order system is very interesting, but seems like to be a little bit inconsistent with my understanding. For example, in many emerging economies, actually, you know, bank credit, you place that in the last place, but bank credit probably is most destructive capital flows. So we usually, you know, experience twin crisis, banking crisis and currency crisis together because of the bank loans and runs on bank loans in most cases. So I'll ask you to comment on that. So let me ask the presenters to respond, maybe in reverse order. So maybe Mike, for 5 minutes, please.
Okay, well,
thank you for to Jose and Janelle for your careful readings of the paper, and also Quan Ho for your comments. I can be relatively brief. So Jose made the point that capital account opening is irreversible, which is kind of true. You don't go from being a wall to being open to being a wall again. We don't see really instances of that. And the data that we have begins in 1995. By that time, countries had gone through this liberalization. So some earlier work that I did 10 or more years ago using Quinn's measure, there were like almost no instances by that one measure where you'd see countries opening then closing again. So I think practically what you see is that by 95, it just happens that these countries, if they're no longer walls, they're no longer walls and they don't go back to that. But one point is that, and this is, you know, I'll refer you to my paper with Jay. When you're a gate country, it's not always ineffective. So the example is Iceland during their crisis, when they put up controls on everything, that seemed to work. But typically, what we see is not a situation like that. It's more like Brazil, where a country will put in place selectively controls on a subset of assets, and that, we argue, is less effective. Janelle's point about the endogeneity bias, Jay and I talk about that in our AEJ macro paper, and we're pretty careful about that. So I would refer you to that rather than go through any details now. What are the objectives of controls? Well, monetary autonomy is certainly one. Maybe it's not always the one, but that's the one that we focused on in our AEJ paper, AEJ macro paper. And in terms of the Chamon and Garcia paper, as you mentioned, that talks about cumulatively there's an effect. But if you think about that chart that I showed you, you know, it would look like there's an effect because they put in place controls, 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 controls. There's no effect, there's no effect, there's no effect. And then there's an effect. So cumulatively, you know, it's a little bit like twice a day a stop clock is right. That's a little harsh, but that's okay. I'm responding to a comment. The point about intensification, that's exactly right. So, you know, we're very clear about that in our article and when we discuss the data set. So that's a dimension that we can't really capture. Frank has done work where he does capture that. But in our data set, that's just not something that's available, unfortunately. It would have been impractical to try to do that for the data that we were collecting for that number of countries, for that range of assets. But what we can do is we can look at inflow controls and outflow controls separately. And that's, you know, what I plan to do with this. So I think that was a very well-founded point. In the IMF Economic Review paper, we do look at the correlation of inflow controls and outflow controls, and it's surprisingly high. I was actually surprised how high it was. But I think, you know, your point is exactly right, that we should be looking at that separately. So this was kind of a quicker way to do it. But I should be looking at that separately. It very well, my guess right now, if I were to bet on it, it wouldn't change things very much because the correlation, it does seem to be quite high. Quan Ho's point, I think that's right. I have to think more about sort of what do we think about in terms of a pecking order. What I had I think your point is very well founded. What I had in mind was sort of the old view of hot money and fixed income instruments, you know, especially short-term ones, are more risky. But I think it merits looking more closely at controls on banks. And finally, sort of a snarky point, I guess, the issue about why are capital controls viewed poorly by Rex Ghosh and I forgot the other co-author. You know, that might be, but it also might be because they don't work very well. So I'm not sure that, you know, their historical argument based on it's associated with autocratic regimes or views that states should no longer be controlling the economy, sort of a Reagan-Thatcherite thing. I'm not sure that, you know, that's, maybe that feeds into it a little bit, but it's far from the only reason. Thank you. And thank you for your comments again.
Thank you. Next is Dr. Kang.
Thank you very much. Thanks for comments from Dr. Jun Kim. I'll be brief. I think Jun Kim is talking about very interesting aspects of the international cooperation, you know, Pareto efficient point of view, I think. I think this is quite correct. If something could be improved by another actions, why then there's a demand for policy coordination or cooperation by the G20 levels? I guess there seems to me there might be, this is not a perfect world, might be some market power frictions out there. So that could be more to do, you know, to try to be getting more Pareto efficient conditions. And I think it seems to me their policy coordination ex ante plus policy adjustment ex post, broadly, I think we can talk about cooperation, you know, itself. So for instance, their currency swap or GFSN might be the policy adjustment ex post, you know. So I guess there, if U.S. monetary policies has been done already, so there's nothing can do we reversely, you know. So we have to take up as an condition itself. So what can you do? So might be some sort of a market. So there might be some useful role of the policy coordination. I myself. On your second, my interesting point is there. You mean talk about remaining policy questions? Still very open question to me. But it seems the one thing might be mindful is that. Well, in terms of, take for instance, exchange rate flexibility, I think the flexibility should be respected, you know. As long as one policymakers can deal with, you know. And the overly flexibility is sometimes detrimental to your economy, then should be kicks in. Is this kind of a first line of defense or second line of defense? So macroprudential should be second line or first line. Seems to me too much addiction of this anxious use of this macroprudential. At the end of the day, kind of big burden to monetary policy itself. So I think it all depends on how do we try to agreeable with the extent of volatility in market variables, for instance, exchange rate. For instance, as seen as we were talking about the volatility in exchange rate in Swiss economy, it's such a huge volatile. But you said this is okay with Swiss economy. Sometimes they couldn't be agreeable if the same thing happened in Korea or other emerging economies. So it all depends on this policymakers thinking about the recognition of this severity of this volatility itself. So. Again, there could be, however, too much premature intervention using macroprudential or capital flow management could spoil the function of adjustment of real exchange rate mechanism. Could be more damaging to policymaking. So it all depends on if you think very hard about that, it seems to me. And what else? Well, I think I think the Basel Committee is a policy. Severe lesson is that the macroprudential should be a lean approach is much more suggested because other than the clean wrapping up later on because that's the what wisdom's. After the GFC, you know. So I think seems to me Basel Committee I think is maybe strong for help, strongly suggestive of their lean approaches for macroprudential uses. And I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lee.
Thank you, Professor Gregorio and Dr. Kim, for valuable comments. I think I need to respond to Dr. Kim's comments. I think it's very good and very helpful for improving the paper. First, I think you asked me to be more kind and user-friendly. I will develop this in that way. I think thank you for this. And second, were leverage caps binding? You asked this. I think leverage caps were never binding because banks, because it is a regulation, so bank, it is bank's reputation is depends on this. When they violate this regulation, I think it affects their reputation, so it never binds. But I think this initial may reflect the policy effect. So they move under some level of ceiling. So this movement may be the effects of policy, I think. Yeah. And second, in Korea's case, it's unclear whether announcement and implementation there are any uncertainties or not. I agree with this one, but the main problem here is a small number of observations to apply qualitative BR. It's a practical matter, so I think it's uncertain whether there is an implementation uncertainty, but if it is not uncertain, I think it does not make much problem, I think. Basically, I admit this one because there is a limitation of observation. The episodes are very scarce. And the third question is related to the previous ones together. So Dr. Kim suggested that to distinguish between the policy effects of leverage caps and macroprudential stability levies, if possible, we'd like to separate those two policies. But if we separate those two policies, smaller number of observations exist. That's a practical problem. I admit the limitation of this analysis also. And for the qualitative VR, why the confidence interval of impulse response narrows? I think it's mainly related to the nature of variables. It's a growth rate, but I will check later why it goes very smaller. I think it's a good point. I will check later. And for the counterfactual analysis, I think he asked me why I didn't represent statistical significance. In the appendix, I compared the in-sample forecast and out-of-sample forecast. These two are different. And in-sample forecast, the interval quantiles are very narrow. And then out-of-sample, they are very diverse. And then we do not think they overlap very much, but I think that's one thing I'd like to mention. And second, I do forecast at many points, so I cannot represent this one in a simple way, so I take the average of medians. So it's easy to represent the median average of median values, and if I want to represent the percentile, it's possible, but I think it's not a good way to represent in a succinct way. So, and Dr. Kim pointed out that qualitative VR and counterfactual analysis, they are the persistence of these two are quite different. The reason is that the qualitative VR is done in terms of growth rate, and then counterfactual analysis is done in terms of level, so they are different, and in this sense, I think they match the, I think the two are saying the same thing. So one is about growth rate, another is about level. So one is more persistent, and the other is persistent is very low. That's the reason why these two estimations look quite different.
Yeah. Oh, please.
Thank you. I'd especially like to thank Jose and Janelle for such excellent and thorough comments. on everyone's papers, including mine. So starting with Jose, I think it's a good idea. In my regressions, I could add a measure of capital mobility. I think that would be interesting, and I may do that. I did think that thinking about the trilemma, you would think that if you were more open to capital, then you would have less monetary independence. That's sort of the logic of the trilemma. And that sort of led me to my choice of Canada as an extreme case, because they're very open. But I have to think, you presented some interesting results on the cluster analysis where, if I understood you, you're saying that in some cases, countries that have very low openness actually had high bond correlations, which is sort of interesting to think about. But even there, it's hard to imagine a country with more bond correlation than Canada has with the US. So I still think Canada is a great choice for me to look at, but you do present some interesting things to look at. The other thing that, Jose, you looked at was GDP correlations, and they're very high, as you say, for US and Canada. And in fact, it's sort of a general result, which actually was apparent in my work and some other people's work, that if you're looking at effects of monetary independence and exchange rate flexibility, GDP growth, either levels or variability, doesn't seem to be where you see big effects. And I don't know why, but what I can tell you is that other things that people care about for monetary policy, like inflation, unemployment, nominal GDP growth, those things are affected in the way I presented. And I don't know quite why you'd get no effect on GDP, but you get a big effect on everything else. I just don't know, but it is a puzzle. But it does suggest that independence and flexibility do help for those variables, which is something. And thank you for raising the issue of currency manipulation. I have done work which obviously is critical of that, and the question is intervening to stabilize the exchange rate somehow at odds with that? And this relates to a point that Janil mentioned. Well, I think it depends on what you're stabilizing. And I guess this is key. Are we stabilizing the exchange rate per se, or are we stabilizing the exchange rate because we want sustainable small current account imbalances? I would argue it's the latter. The point is really to minimize large deviations up or down in a country's trade balance or current account balance. And in that case, as long as you're symmetric, it seems that that's a reasonable thing to do. And in fact, Janil, you raised the question. You sounded uncertain as to whether you should sell reserves with a capital outflow, as China is doing. But I would argue it should, and it is the right thing to do, because a sustained capital outflow would give you a large current account surplus that might not be what you want forever. And you should lean against. Now, you should lean against it by selling reserves. But It's one thing to lean against the wind. It's another thing to defend an exchange rate level. And not, we all know that selling reserves to defend a peg can get you into trouble because you might run out of reserves and then you have a sharp change. But I would say you don't do it with any level. You're not defending any level. You're just leaning against the wind. So then you could be symmetric. So then the key would be if you have a surplus, you sell reserves. If you have a deficit, you buy reserves, at least beyond a certain point. And then manipulation would be the opposite. If you were buying reserves when you had a surplus, that would be manipulation. Then the other point, Janil, was do my results say that inflation targeting and inflexible exchange rates are deflationary? And no. I mean, that's not the case. First of all, the big deflationary countries are not in my sample. Germany and Japan, and even the US to some extent, are not in my sample. The only deflationary country is Switzerland, but most of these countries have high inflation rates and indeed too high. So it's actually a good thing that the inflation targeters don't have 5 or 6% inflation. They have, you know, 1 or 2% inflation. So I take that as a good thing, not a bad thing. It's not deflation. I do control for per capita GDP, but I could break the sample for to EM, advanced economies, and EMs. I'm not sure it's quite large enough. Let me conclude, though, with I think the interesting question that Kwan Ho asked about. What is the difference between Canada and emerging markets in terms of monetary independence? Well, I would say, generically, I think currency mismatches is a key thing which has been raised. Canada does not have a currency mismatch. And this came up earlier. currency mismatch is not the same thing as a negative net investment position. Canada has a negative net investment position. They're net debtors to the world, but they have no currency mismatch. They borrow in their own currency. So they're different issues. Canada has no mismatch. Many emerging markets do. Policy credibility is another one. Canada has built up over 20 years of good policy credibility. I would say that Korea is now there. Korea, I believe, has good credit policy credibility built up over time, and it has really eliminated, as far as I can tell, a currency mismatch. I mean, I think the regulatory changes you've had have really, I think Korea is in a much better position than Koreans tell me it is. I actually think Korea is well positioned to weather the next storm, and I would say Korea is now in a position to be where Canada is, I think, personally. So I think the key thing is that if you face a large exchange rate swing, don't immediately think it's a disaster. You know, that's what Canada does. Canada had a 30% devaluation in the past 3 years. They did not treat this as a disaster. They welcomed it to a large extent. And that's the key, because these exchange rate swings aren't as damaging as you may fear. So I think Korea is there.
Okay, thank you very much. We don't have much time left, but let me open up to the floor and take maybe 3 questions at most. Yeah, Frank?
Thank you. So I just want to pick up on that last point that Joe made, which I think is very important. When we think about currency mismatches and how they've been eliminated in many countries around the world, so not just Korea. This, to me, is one of the biggest changes in the global financial system in the past 15 years or so, the development of the local currency bond markets and how the borrowing has not had to be done in foreign currency. And this then gives a lot more flexibility. And so we can talk, so we've had rapid dollar appreciation the past few years. If we go back 20 years ago, that would have led to a lot of bankruptcies in emerging markets. Now we can talk about the pain of the dollar appreciation in terms of basis points, and that's exactly what Canada can do and say, okay, this is a drag on certain aspects of the economy, but this is that's fine, right? That's a good problem to have. So that's one point. And I think there was a nice 2004 IIE book before the P got put into the Peterson Institute by Morris Goldstein and Philip Turner on currency mismatches, and I think we just need to do more work on that particular topic. My second point is on Michael's work on capital controls. I think is wonderful, and there's a lot of discussions about gates and walls, and so I think this is it's a positive way to think about these things. There's been discussions about the effects of capital controls, and it was mentioned a few times that it affects the composition of capital flows. I would caution against that interpretation. It certainly affects the composition of reported capital flows. I don't know that that means that it affects the composition of actual capital flows, and we should recognize that there's a distinction there. My students, I only teach business school students, they absolutely love capital controls because it leads to higher premiums for financial engineers. So they just look at it as welfare policy to MBA students. And I don't think we should be in that business, but that's one effect of, but the reported capital control, capital flows, absolutely we'll see a movement in the composition. I just don't know if it's real or not.
Okay, please.
I have a question to Professor Klein. You discuss switches between capital controls and no controls for gate countries. What is the driving factor for that? Is it the same across countries? Is it just the exchange rate? And then you look at the efficacy of capital control on exchange rates? Or shouldn't we make a distinction between the underlying reason why countries put this versus that capital control or remove trends in capital flows as well as exchange rate movements, asset price movements, credit growth, it could be anything. And the second related question is, when you assume the capital control is to mitigate exchange rate appreciation or depreciation, we implicitly assume capital flows are behind the exchange rate movement. And in the morning, we had this discussion about quantity versus price. How can we, do you have any insights in that?
Okay, so your first question, what causes capital controls to be levied? That's a great question, and I don't have an answer. And I tried really hard to get an answer, because what I wanted to do is to be able to instrument, when I was doing this research, to be able to instrument, but in a systematic way, you know, with a large data set, I found it, you know, very hard to explain what caused the imposition of capital controls. So in certain instances, like in Brazil, you know, they said it was because of currency wars. So there it was very clear. And that gets to your second question. I think that was really the goal in that episode of what was going on. But more broadly, I think it's difficult. I have a good friend who is a political scientist, Jeff Frieden, and he said, oh, it's, you know, just interest groups, because if you're a political scientist, your answer is always, oh, it's just interest groups, whereas our answer is always, oh, it's just markets. So I don't, you know, it's a very good question, and I wish I had an answer, because that would mean I could run IV regressions. But it's something I haven't been able to really figure out yet.
Okay, let me collect one more if there's any other questions. Okay, then, Joe, Frank just says that, you know, even emerging economies don't have currency match problems. So how do you respond to that?
Well, I agree with Frank. I mean, they're not totally gone. There certainly are plenty of point, you can point to cases. Turkey stands out in my mind, but it's a huge improvement, absolutely. And I think the BIS has pointed out lately the extent to which there are still some lingering areas, but so we have further work to do, but the progress is quite large. And I think in Korea's case in particular, I do think the problem is as far as I can tell, over.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me close the session, and please join me in thanking the presenters and discussants.